ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of the College of Humanities and Social Sciences, I'm honored to welcome you all to our 7th Annual International Translation Conference under the theme Politics of Translation, Representations and Power. Our annual translation conferences aim to build a Gulf-based platform related to discussing issues related to translation. And our conference for this year sheds the light on the role of power relations in shaping the politics of translation. Please know that we will be taking photographs of this event, so if you prefer not to be photographed, you can sit to the left area of the auditorium. Before we start the first day of the conference, I would like to invite you all to post and tweet about the conference using the hashtag TII_conf7, and you will see it at the bottom of the screen on the slides. To initiate our conference, please welcome to the stage Dr. Amal Al Malki, Dean of College of Humanities and Social Sciences at Hamad bin Khalifa University, for her opening remarks.
It's my pleasure to welcome you all today to the 7th edition of the annual International Translation Conference, whose theme this year has resonated positively with the local and international academic and professional communities. This year's theme, Politics of Translation, Representations and Power, has proven yet again that the fields of translation and interpreting are interdisciplinary and linger across any field that has a human component to it, which are by default all fields of knowledge and inquiries. The process of politicization has affected all disciplines, and translation in specific has been utilized all through history, especially in the nation-building historical phases, playing a role on the one hand in the modernization of the nations, and on the other hand, the decolonization of language and culture, and in between that, in setting agendas toward other cultures through methods of indigenization and foreignization. In recent years, we have witnessed how translation has been pivotal in the emerging competing national narratives, adopting new means of communication, reaching beyond the restrictions of age, gender, and language. We see how subtitling and dubbing, for example, have given access to local struggles that could have been contained within certain historical and cultural moments. But these translated audiovisual pieces have been given access to a wider audience from different linguistic and cultural communities, succeeding in gaining international sympathy. This and many examples through history pose translation as a powerful political and humanitarian tool. The interplay between translation and politics is not a new one. However, it's a critical one in today's globalized world. It's the means of cross-cultural understanding and communication, and the basis of dialogues. Language is at the heart of representation. In a world where identities are hyphenated, and where migration and displacement are major demographic factors, linguistic identities transcend geographical borders. However, one still needs to investigate how language can be a uniting as well as a dividing element. Language as a major component of identity has also been politicized and has been the pillar of a discourse that is feeding into national anxieties. National movements in the so-called East and West have ranged from language revivals to reservations of indigenous languages and indigenous cultures to the more negative escalation of the tone of fear against the coexistence of other languages and other cultures. Many see the world from the dichotomous lenses of the global and the local, looking at them as two competing realities. But few would consider the middle ground to be one hybrid reality, where there is no longer a clear cut between the global and the local. And instead, we find a globalized local and a localized global. Politics have played a role in this year's conference. The unfortunate events of Belgium last week and the closure of the airport have made us both anxious and adamant in having our panelists from Belgium join us. Our team has worked closely on their travel logistics, and I'm very, very happy to say that our colleagues from Belgium are here with us today. This is an opportunity to express our solidarity as scholars and professionals in the College of Humanities and Social Sciences with the Belgium and French people against terrorism, bigotry, and intolerance. The translation conference that started 7 years ago as a small intellectual gathering has become a yearly reference for academics, media specialists, diplomats, as well as the general public. This year's theme, has attracted a wide range of topics, some of which are presented for the first time in Qatar. For example, papers dealing with interpreting in conflict zones. We're featuring 10 academic panels over 2 days. And in celebration of Qatar-China Culture Year 2016, we have dedicated a panel for our colleagues from China that will be focusing on how Western culture and ideology entered China through the mediation of translation. We're hosting 32 panelists from Egypt, Spain, UK, Portugal, China, Iran, Turkey, Belgium, Switzerland, Saudi Arabia, Morocco, Algeria, Canada, and the United States. These panelists come from the most prestigious universities in the world, such as University of Lausanne, Beijing, Foreign Studies, University of Glasgow, University of Geneva, Lebanese University, University of Ottawa, and others. We're also holding one seminar that features a new solution in translation studies, in which new technology are used to help make translation evaluation more objective and more efficient. And we have been keen on offering a holistic experience to our audience. We have 3 afternoon professional workshops targeted towards professional translators and Arabic language trainers. And we will begin with an opening session and end with a closing session. Furthermore, we have 2 important additions to this year's conference. First is the Interpreting Exhibition and Exhibition Hall 1, an exhibition organized in collaboration with the University of Salamanca, documenting the largely forgotten activity of interpreters during Nuremberg trials in 1945 and 1946. The trials are considered to be a rich case study on the professional interpreters who highly contributed to the smooth running of the Nuremberg trials, interpreting between the judges, the prosecutions, the defense, the witness, and the accused, who spoke German, French, English, and Russian. This exhibition sheds the light on the vital role these interpreters played, especially in making communicative process possible during the trials, where people speak different languages and come from different cultural backgrounds. Although their physical position in the trials was not highlighted in the pictures, pointing out the invisibility of the interpreters, those trials would have never been successful without them. Aside from their contribution to the success of the trials, the exhibition also highlights the challenges they went through, whether on the professional or the personal level. In several cases, families of the interpreters were executed or forced to migrate out of Germany or Austria upon court decision against some Nazi defendants. In other cases, the interpreters themselves were imprisoned. The second addition to this year's conference is yet another exceptional collaboration, and I'm very pleased to announce the launch of the Arabic version of the medical booklet, Other Words, Other Meanings, A Guide to Healthcare Interpreting in an International Setting, الترجمة الفورية في رحاب الرعاية الصحية. That was a result of a collaboration between the Translation and Interpreting Institute and the Geneva University Hospitals. The booklet has been translated into English, Spanish, Italian, German, Russian, and now into Arabic by our own professionals. The idea originated by Professor Louis Sultan from Geneva University Hospitals, who tells me, and I quote, in the 1990s, Europe and Switzerland experienced an increased influx of refugees and asylum seekers and migrants coming from various parts of the world. In Geneva, where I was in charge of a unit providing care to many of them, medical professionals were confronted with serious difficulties in communicating with them when they did not speak French, the local language, German or English. We had to find people ready to translate what the patients were saying and asking for. With the help of the local Red Cross, who started to identify and train medical interpreters, but realized that doctors and nurses needed also to be trained on how to work with them. So we created a working group composed of interpreters, mediators, and medical professionals to design a simple and practical document which could be used by health professionals in different contexts. Doctors and nurses were trained to use it, and very quickly it became quite successful. End of quote. When the possibility of translating the Arabic version was presented to us, we didn't hesitate for a second, because we fully believe of its importance now more than ever. Although community interpreting is non-existent in Qatar, it is much needed. In a country where the expatriate communities make up the majority of the population, there is a dire need for establishing policies and institutionalizing interpreting services. The right for an interpreter is the right to be heard and understood. And the lack of language leads to a lack of understanding, lack of trust, and eventually, lack of harmony in the community. As Qatar is part of the Arab region and shoulders the same worries and burdens, we think of the refugees from Syria, Iraq, and other Arab countries, whose only hope now is to be heard and understood. Interpreting from and into Arabic can still be improved, and this guide can be used as a practical manual in healthcare across the Arab countries, hoping for many others. At the same time, we hope in the Translation Interpreting Institute to play an effective role in promoting interpreting in general and community interpreting in specific as both an academic field and profession in the region. And now, my opening remarks come to an end, and I thank you again for your attention and for joining us today. Thank you. Now we begin sparking the discussion panel with our keynote speakers. Before introducing those who are physically here, I need to let you know that our keynote, Dima Khatib, will be joining us shortly, however virtually, via Skype. She had to travel for work reasons. If technology doesn't fail, she'll be joining us very soon. Another note is as we attempt to foster intellectual discussions and aim to engage you, the audience, otherwise the discussion will be tilted and incomplete. We have assigned a generous time after our speakers' presentations for your questions and your comments. And we hope that all will be constructive and ignite a civil and healthy discussion as we expect from you. It gives me immense pleasure to introduce our first keynote, allow me to switch into Arabic, Professor Henry Awaiss. تتوزع أنشطة البروفيسور هنري أويس على ميادين التعليم والبحث والتأليف وقد أولى عملية النشر أهمية خاصة منذ سنوات بعيدة فأصدر وزميلة بروفيسور حردان سلسلة المصدر الهدف المتخصصة بقضايا الترجمة وإشكالياتها وبما نتج عنها من ترجمية ومصطلحية وتاريخ كما أنه يشدد على التدريب المتواصل وشارك في المؤتمرات والندوات المحلية والإقليمية والدولية وله مساهمات كثيرة فيها وقد تولى رئاسة تحرير الكينيا وهي حوليات معهد اللغات والترجمة الذي أدار منذ سنة 1996 إلى سنة 2012 كما يتولى حاليا رئاسة تحرير بوابة اللغات وهي حوليات كلية اللغات التي تولى عمادتها منذ تأسيسها 2012 ويذكر أنه ساهم في تأسيس مدرسة الترجمة بيروت سنة 1980 وهو لازال في رحاب جامعة القديس يوسف وانتخب عضوا في المكتب الإداري للمؤتمر الدولي الدائم للمعاهد الجامعية للمترجمين والتراجمة المعروف بالمختصر سويتي عام 2011 Please join me to welcome the professor.
أصحاب السعادة السفراء حضرة السيدة العميدة أعضاء الهيئة التعليمية في الكلية والمعهد أيها الزملاء أيها الزميلات والزملاء الأصدقاء الطالبات والطلاب خلافا لما هو مقرر لم أبدأ بالمداخلة ولكنني سأبوح بسر جمعني أنا والسيدة فاطمة وهذا السر يقول بأن جامعة القديس يوسف بيروت قررت أن تمنع السيدة العميدة ميدالية الجامعة بمناسبة احتفالها بيوبيلها 140 فلتتفضل وتتسلم مني عربونة وشاكرة وأعلام صريحة عن جوزية الجامعة للتعاون مع المعهد. سيدتي. أما بالنسبة إلى الموضوع الذي سأتناوله فعندي بعض الأفكار أرغب في أن أبدأ بها. والفكرة الأولى تقول بأنني لست أدري إذا كانت الترجمة وحدها من بين المعارف هي التي تستهلك هذا الكم الهائل من الأزواج بينوم أو الثنائيات. وقد ظهر هذا الواقع جلياً عندما عملنا على مؤلف يدعى مصطلحات تعليم الترجمة Terminologie de la traduction لمؤلفي كورميه يانكي ودليل وأصدرناه في سلسلة متخصصة تعرف باسم كوليكسيون سور سيب سلسلة مصدر الهدف في بيروت سنة 2002 كما ظهر في خلال المؤلفات التي اشتهر بها ترجميو فرنسا لترادكتولوج ان فرانس انطلاقا من جورج مونا الى الحديث نيكولا فلوريجيل مرورا بجان روني لادميرال وداليكا سيليسكوفيتش وماريان لوديرير وميشيل بالارد غني عن القول ان كل زوجين او كل ثنائي يثيران كما هائلا من المسائل والمواقف والنظريات وكما ترون أنا وضعت تصميماً هو المسألة والمسألة طرحتها حول هذا التساؤل إذا كانت كل المعارف تشترك مع الترجمة والترجمية في هذه الثنائية أو في الأزواج وقد اخترت من الأزواج كما هو ظاهر اللغة أو اللسان والترجمة الألسنية والترجمية الكاتب والمترجم المؤلف والمترجم المترجم والترجمان أهل المصدر أهل الهدف الأمانة والخيانة صناعة الكتابة صناعة الترجمة الاستحالة الإمكان والمقاربة والنظر ولابد لي من كلمة أتوقف فيها عند كل زوجين فأقول عن اللغة إنها أمر والترجمة أمر آخر وكما يعلن جان روني لادميرال فإن الترجمة قد استخدمت في تعليم اللغات الأجنبية ولكن هذا الأمر لا يتعلق مباشرة بفعل الترجمة كما هو مطلوب إنما الترجمة أدت دوراً هو وسيلة لتعلم اللغة الأجنبية وأكيد قامت بعد ذلك نظريات تقول بأن تعلم لغة أجنبية يجب ألا يمر إطلاقاً بالترجمة بل عرف وانتشر ما يعرف بالبان لغويستيك أو الحمام اللغوي أو الحمام الألسني أي الانغماس في واقع هذه اللغة دون اللجوء إلى الترجمة ومن هنا بدأت الترجمة بعملية استقلال وأشير إلى ما تم عندنا في بيروت فببيروت قبل 1980 كان الخلق قائما في الإجازة كأن يقول عنوان الإجازة إجازة في اللغة كذا في اللغة العربية وأدابها ثم شريطة بعدها اختيار الترجمة أي أن الترجمة كانت تبعا لهذه الإجازة في الأداب وفي اللغة كذلك هي الحال حتى الآن في الكثير من الدول العربية لا سيما في الفروع الإنجليزية إذن تم العمل على أن تعترف الجامعة بأن الترجمة قائمة بحد ذاتها ولها مدرستها ولها كليتها ولها موادها وهي ليس عالة لا على الأدب ولا على اللغة إنما قائمة مساق قائم بحد ذاته بحد نفسه وككل الجمهوريات المستقلة حديثا وجدت الترجمة لكي تفرض نفسها صعوبات كثيرة في البداية كان يجب أن نقنع الزملاء بأنها مادة مستقلة قائمة بحد ذاتها ثم الطلاب ثم تغيير في الذهنية وتدريجا منذ 1980 وأنا أمثل على ذلك بما جرى في بيروت تم والحمد لله وعوضا عن المدرسة الواحدة صار عدد المدارس في لبنان 10 مدارس للترجمة أو كليات للترجمة وليس غريبا فقد استبدلنا كل الحواجز وقد استبدلنا كل الحروب ب 45 جامعة. ثم أنتقل إلى الزوج الآخر الألسنية والترجمة. الألسنية هي أصلا مراقبة كيفية عمل اللغة وقد قام في بدايات في خمسينات وستينات القرن الماضي هذا الخلاف بين القواعد جرامير لينغويستيك واعتبرت الترجمة بأنها المنحة التطبيقي للألسنية ولكن الألسنية قامت بحد ذاتها ويمكن الكلام عن أنها علم يراقب كيفية عمل اللغة والترجمية تريد أن تكون كذلك هي علم قائم بحد ذاته علم أقول علم وقد درست زميلة لنا في بيروت لا سيانتيفيسيتي دو لا ترادكتولوجي أي أن الترجمية تقرع باب العلم وهي قد قرعته وفتح لها الباب وهي معروفة بأنها علم قائم بحد ذاته هذه الترجمية تسمى في بيروت ترجمية وفي بعض الدول المتأثرة بالفرنكوفونية بينما تسمى في المتأثر بالإنجليزية الأنجلوساكسونية دراسات في الترجمة هنا زوج آخر تعرفونه تماما هي هذه العلاقة بين الكاتب والمترجم والمؤلف والمترجم وغالبا ما نرى صفات كثيرة تعطى للمترجم فطارة هو القرصان الذي يسطو على مركب المؤلف وطارة هو المزور لسكوك ملكية النص من يملك هذا النص لكن علاقة تقوم علاقة فعلية تقوم بين الكاتب والمترجم وإذا شئنا فلنقل بأنه على الكاتب أن يبقى كاتبا وعلى المترجم أن يبقى مترجما علما بأن كيمياء معينة تقوم بين الكاتب والمترجم وهنا أعني بالطبع الميدان الأدبي وليس الميدان البراغماتي فأي علاقة ستنشأ بين كتيب صغير يشرح كيف يتم تركيب الغسالة أو غير ذلك ثم قام ثنائي آخر أو زوج آخر هو المترجم والترجمان في بداية تجربتنا في بيروت كان كل الناس يؤيدون الترجمان لأن الترجمان الانتربريت مصيره هو الأمم المتحدة هو نيويورك أما المترجم وأنا مترجم فهو يعني ليس بالطبقة الأولى لن يجلس يوما بين عظماء العالم بين رئيس ورئيس وبين مسؤول ومسؤول فيما الترجمان هو يؤدي هذا الدور وصولا إلى أهل المصدر وأهل الهدف التي اقترحها جان روني الأدميرال وأعلن عن أبوته لهذا التصنيف وظن البعض أنه يقسم الترجمة إلى حزبين ونحن في لبنان عندنا خبرة الأحزاب فجاء سيرجيو فاجيو يقول بنزعة توافقية وسطية تقول سديبان جماعة الحسبية يعني ممكن أن أكون من أهل المصدر وممكن أن أكون من أهل الهدف قضية ثانية قائمة أيضا على الإزدواجية هي الأمانة والخيانة علما بأن في بعض الأحيان نرتكب الخيانة من أجل الأمانة ولدينا أطروحة تدرسها زميلة لنا في امتداح الخيانة أي في عدم اللجوء إلى التقيد حرفيا بالرصف لكل ما هو وارد في النص وهنا من هذا الباب ندخل إلى ثنائية سابعة هي صناعة الكتابة وصناعة الترجمة هذه العلاقة الحميمة القائمة بين فعل الكتابة لك دكرير وبين فعل الترجمة لك دكرير ولكن سابقا أنا لا أتناقض عندما تحدثت عن العلاقة بين الكاتب والمترجم إنما أريد أن أتوقف عند الصنعة بحد ذاتها فهي حرفة فهي نتعلمها كيفية الكتابة وكيفية الترجمة وصولا الى الزوج التاسع وقد طرحه جورج هنا منذ البدايه في لبلزم فيدال الاستحاله والامكان. بدايه ياتي بنظريه تقول بان الترجمه هي عمليه مستحيله. لا يمكن ان تقوم عمليه الترجمه، هذا نحن نترجم منذ عده سنوات منذ مئات السنين. ثم الامكانيه الثانيه هي إمكانية الترجمة ولكن في ميادين معينة. الجاحظ في حيوانه رفض الترجمة كليا لأسباب معينة، وبقيت علامة استفهام حول قدسية النص، يترجم أو لا يترجم، كيف نترجمه. عقد منذ شهر في طرابلس لبنان مؤتمر حول ترجمة معاني القرآن، المعاني، ولا نقول ترجمة الكتاب بحد ذاته نظرا للإعجاز الوارد فيه. ثم بعد ذلك أصل إلى المقاربة والنظرية. تعاني قاموس الترجمة أو قاموس الترجميات يعاني من دفق هائل في التسمية. مثلا المقاربة النظرية، المقاربة هي كيفية التعامل مع النص approach، أما النظرية فهي الخروج بإشكالية معينة أو بقضية معينة ومحاولة تفسيرها ودراستها بالعمق. هذا يعود إلى النظرية. وقد جمعت في القسم الثاني في مجموعات. المجموعة الأولى عنوانها العلاقة القائمة للرلاسيون بين اللسان والترجمة، بين الألسنية والترجمية. المجموعة الثانية هي أفرقاء هذه العملية لزكتور، الكاتب المترجم المؤلف المترجم المترجم الترجمان. المجموعة الثالثة الاستراتيجيات بين أهل المصدر وأهل الهدف، بين جماعة الأمانة وما يعرفون من يعرفون عنه بالخيانة. المجموعة الرابعة المنتج البرودوي، ويقوم من خلال صناعة الكتابة وصناعة الترجمة. والمجموعة الخامسة هي العودة إلى البدء، رتور أو بوان زيرو، رتور أو ديبار، وهو بين القضية استحالة الترجمة أو إمكانية الترجمة وبين المقاربة والنظرية. وأعددت كما ترون لائحة بالمسائل التي تهم الترجمة والترجمية، وأعلن بأن سلسلة المصدر الهدف الواردة في كتالوج سنتي 2013-2014 والحديث وقيد الإعداد لنا حوالي 30 مؤلف متخصص في الترجمة والترجمية. وقد قررت إدارة الكلية أن تهب المعهد هنا هذه المجموعة وستصلها خلال أسبوعين. أنهي بأن السياسة المرجوة، أي نعني بالسياسة تدبير شؤون الترجمة وشجونها، تستند إلى الثنائيات أو الأزواج، بمعنى أنها سترجح كفة واحد من الزوجين أو تساوي بينهما أو تقترح رديفا أو حلا وسطيا أو الأفضل أفقا أوسع. والأهم هو ككل مشاكلنا ترسيم الحدود بين الزوجين، كل واحد ترسيم الحدود بين كل واحد من الزوجين. هذا يعود للغة، هذا يعود للترجمة، علما بأن علاقات وثيقة تقوم بينهما لكي يصل بنا الأمر إلى الاحترام، أشدد على هذا المفهوم، ولكي يؤدي بنا الاحترام إلى الاعتراف بالفريق الآخر، بالعضو الآخر في الزوجين. أشكر لكم.
I'm very excited about our second speaker. Sultan Sooud Al Qassemi is a United Arab Emirates-based columnist whose articles have appeared in the Financial Times, The Independent, The Guardian, The Huffington Post, The New York Times Room for Debate, Foreign Policy, Open Democracy, and The Globe and Mail, as well as other notable publications. Al Qassemi is also a prominent commentator on Arab affairs on Twitter. Rising in prominence during the Arab Spring, his tweets became a major news source. rivaling the major news networks at that time, until Time magazine listed him in the 140 best Twitter feeds of 2011. Al-Qassemi is an MIT Media Labs Director's Fellow, and in 2014, Arabian Business placed Al-Qassemi in its list of world's 100 most powerful Arabs under the thinkers category. He continues both to write and tweet about the Arab world, both from his hometown in Sharjah, as well as while giving lectures internationally. Al-Qassemi is also the founder of Barjil Art Foundation, an independent initiative established to contribute to the intellectual development of the art scene in the Arab region by building a prominent and publicly accessible art collection in the United Arab Emirates. Barjil Art Foundation currently has exhibitions at the Aga Khan Museum in Toronto and the Whitechapel Gallery in London. Please join me to welcoming Sultan Sooud Al Qassemi.
I apologize for that very long introduction. أولا بدي أشكركم باللغة العربية. يسرني جدا أن أكون متواجد بينكم في بلدي الثاني قطر وفي هذه المدينة الحبيبة. سأتحدث باللغة الإنجليزية. فإذا أردتم أن تستخدموا المترجم. أنا أولاً لست مترجم كيف يعني بروفيشنال؟ محترف ولكن مترجم عرضي أو مترجم صدفة. So thank you very much for hosting me here. I am not a professional translator. I am an accidental, coincidental translator. And I will use my experience in the last few years as a case study for coincidental translation. So if you bear with me. So in, So in 2011, as some of you might have heard, there was a series of uprisings in the Arab world that toppled a few governments, beginning in Tunisia, but also spreading across to other countries, including Egypt, Syria, and elsewhere. I started translating, again, coincidentally. I had some time on my hand. And it was a very interesting time for me because I'm a political writer. So this was a seismic event that was taking place in the region. And I felt that I wanted to contribute in one way or the other. And so I dedicated several weeks, perhaps several months of my life into translating almost on a daily basis, on an hourly and sometimes minute by minute basis, some of the events that were taking place. I ended up going to Egypt on the first anniversary of the uprising in 2012. Because of my Twitter feed, as Dr. Amal has kindly stated, because of the immediate translation I was offering, Time magazine had chosen me as one of the most important Twitter feeds. And in fact, when my friends called me and said, Sultan, your name is on the Time magazine list of some list on Time magazine, and it said 100 or so most recommended followers. I didn't know where my name was. So I went on celebrities, I didn't find myself. I went on athletes, I didn't find myself. I went on singers and entertainers, I didn't find myself. And then finally, I found myself under news channels. So it was under the category of news channels. So just as an example of showing you how a person who, and I will be holding this way, just to show you how a person who could be from his home in Doha or Cairo or any other city in the world can contribute in the world of instant translation. I will talk a bit more about this. So, for example, The Guardian was quoting some of the comments here, as well as some other publications, New York Times, BBC, and other publications that I came to see quoting some of the translation. But we want to talk about why they were doing that, I think, which is perhaps interesting. And what is, being a person, I can choose what to include and what to remove. I mean, in the end, I'm not a major news organization, so I have influence on what I can choose to omit from the translation. And have I done that? Did I do this? Did I omit anything? And it is an interesting question. You know, this is the first time in my life I've been asked to talk about translation. So thanks to Dr. Emman. And so, you know, I was going over the internet, and my colleague who was helping me came across this interesting document on WikiLeaks, citing me. So they were comparing my translation with that of BBC monitoring. So what I did versus what BBC monitoring was doing. And I'm not sure if you are familiar with BBC monitoring. They go over news channels and they search what has been happening. And so in this case, they have a comparison between my Twitter feed and the BBC monitoring. And remember, this goes into US diplomats only, so we're not supposed to see this. I apologize to any US government officials who might be here for sharing this document. So here you have BBC's monitoring version. I just want to read to you maybe a couple of lines. So this was on the 20th of February 2011. Muammar Gaddafi gave one of his very, very famous speeches. By the way, that was the pivot, the tipping point in my translation, I think, because, you know, I was translating word for word what he was saying, sometimes even with the mistakes that he was making. So, for example, he was saying things like, don't believe what is written in Kleenex. He meant WikiLeaks, but he didn't know it. And he said, don't believe Bookface, which I suppose some of you can guess what Bookface was. So I was translating word for word versus the BBC translation, which would say, which is what we're going to be looking at here. So for example, the BBC translation would tell you, Muammar Gaddafi gave a speech, and he said, people abroad, you know, he admitted, he said, he added, you know, he also added, he also said. So it's sort of an interesting, you know, rundown or summary of what was happening by BBC, a very prestigious organization. As you can see, it's quite long, and this is my translation of the event, or this is the WikiLeaks cable. So compare BBC to what I was doing. So what I was doing is, rather than saying he said and he added, I was translating it into, I saw that I had to speak to you. I don't have a paper. I will speak to you in Libyan. I don't have, you know, it's always in the first person that I was translating, because it was word for word. And there seems to have been a barrier that was broken between the translation of he said, he added, he noted, rather than I say, I add. Yeah, that would be actually a great service to humanity. is this working? Okay, great. So we're looking at, this is an example also from the BBC monitoring, where they're saying the speech ended at almost 22 minutes to midnight on GMT. He went on for about 4 hours. I had sore fingers by the time he ended. And BBC is telling its viewers that the speech will be processed as text and completed by close of business tomorrow. By close of business tomorrow. So this is what BBC is offering you as a follower. Come back in 18 hours or so, and you will have the text. I don't know how many people would be waiting in a 24-hour news cycle for 18 hours, 16 hours to get the full rundown of the news. And also, this is not exactly the full version. This is maybe a more extended version of what we read. So what is this? I'll skip this. So here, this is what I compare, what he said, he admitted, versus what I say, I had to speak to you. And I believe that if you are trying to study the mind of a megalomaniac, of which unfortunately we have so many in the region, that you also want to know what they're thinking. That when they say things like, you know, I want to speak to you in your accent, in our accent, in Libya. I refuse to speak to you in classical Arabic. So the leader here is endearing himself to his people, saying, I won't speak to you in this classical Arabic. I will speak to you in your own language. Believe me, trust me. So these are things that perhaps a major news network would not generally include. Another thing I noticed during my few weeks in translation is a translator needs to be not only bilingual, but bicultural. And believe it or not, even if you are an Arab, you're not really bicultural across the board in the Arab states. So I might know 99% of Qatari culture. I'm from the UAE, I have family in Doha, and I come from down the road. Doesn't mean that I know everything about Doha. There are certain issues, including geographical references, including very specific phrases about the country that you're unable to translate. So imagine if you are a French and English speaker and you're trying to translate not only between French in Belgium and French in France, but also French in Ivory Coast. Is it the same French? For me, not really, it's quite different. So it's important also to take the bicultural nature into translation into mind. So here, for example, so here we ask if a translator is merely an intermediary or also a content producer. And I remember seeing this because Time Magazine and New York Times and others were using my translation as part of the content. And so there's this added responsibility that I wasn't just translating for my friends or for some people, but it was really for mass publication. I'll skip this. And another thing I would I'd like to maybe point to is the role of the fixer. And I don't know if I was ever a fixer, but a lot of us who write, who translate books or articles or speeches, we rely on fixers, and many of us never cite them. Because fixers aren't only intermediaries of language, but they're also intermediaries of culture. And unfortunately, when there's so many journalists who have been killed in the last several years in the Middle East, especially and across the world, sometimes the fixers who are with them, they're translators, but no one ever mentions them as journalists. So this is an interesting point that people, someone wrote, it's a thankless job being a fixer. So here I would like to give an example of putting the translation into context for the followers online. For example, in January 2011, there was a major step taken by the Emir of Kuwait to visit Iraq and attend the Arab League summit. And if you're familiar with the recent Middle East history, Saddam's forces occupied Kuwait for a number of months in 1990 and 1991. And so here I say, well, Kuwait Emir would attend the planned March meeting, but so what for people who are outside the Gulf and outside the Middle East? What does it mean? So what? So I try to put things into context where say, well, if this visit does happen, it would be the equivalent of Charles de Gaulle visit to Bonn, Germany in 1962. And we might know that there was major war between them and the world, so it was a very, very significant visit. So it's important also to put the translation into context for international audiences. And in this case, I try to be a little bit cheeky, apologies to any Canadians here, but I try to use some colloquial Arabic, Gulf, or classical Arabic sayings, and also translate them because of people who might be interested in bicultural translation. Well, I had difficulty translating some Egyptian. As I said, I know Arabic, or I thought I knew Arabic, but apparently the Egyptians don't only speak Arabic because they had some words that they were using that were quite alien to me. So from someone from the Gulf, so during the uprising, they said that the SCAF, or the Supreme Council of the Armed Forces, or the military government, or Mubarak, or whoever was in charge then, would issue a faraman. And I had no idea what faraman was, so I was translating second by second. And imagine the speech is coming up and the news is breaking, so what do you do? Who do you call? Hello, it's a faraman. So do you know what a faraman is? So it turns out that faraman is a Turkish word or Ottoman word, which means announcement. I'm sure many of you are more knowledgeable than me, but someone coming from the Gulf, this was quite a statement that I've never heard before, what a faraman was, and was used by some Egyptians. And then also when you translate words from the street, there are some words that I didn't know about, such as shamarich. And I thought, to be honest with you, when I was translating, and I thought shamarich meant gunfire. I thought that, oh my God, somebody is shooting shamarich. Shamarich sounds like it's a very bad thing. So it turns out that shamarich actually means fireworks. And I don't remember whether it was celebratory or if it was, you know, trying to shoot someone with fireworks, but it wasn't as sinister as a gunshot. So it's also, you know, you're caught unawares. And I remember when I was doing the translation, I had my laptop open into phrases. I have no idea what military ranks are. What is Amid and what is Liwa and what is all this? Thank God I have zero knowledge on military affairs. But it was important to say that if so-and-so is a Mushir, what does Mushir say? Obviously, he's more important than officer, but what is the exact rank? And another thing I tried to do, I just remembered, was try to put things into context geographically. So when they would say, for example, that there was a protest in the town of Mahalla, what is Mahalla? It doesn't mean anything for people outside the Middle East or outside Egypt, but it's a big deal, Mahalla, because Mahalla was, it's an industrial town, it's a town, so I would add Mahalla, between brackets, 120 kilometers north of Cairo, industrial town, population XYZ. It is also the city from where the April 6th movement initiated in 2000, a few years before, I think 2008, 2009. So it's quite an important city. And so if you don't provide the context, you're really losing so much in the translation. Here I just translated some boring political speeches by people who are today not really in the field. But another thing I was trying to do is whenever I find an interview, I try to find one with English subtitles. So it's not just an important interview with an Arab leader. I try to see if there is a version of it on YouTube or elsewhere that has English subtitles. And as you see, a lot of these journalists who are saying, thank you for finding the one with the English language subtitles. I try to be helpful to other people in the field. This was the major announcement of February 11th, 2011, when Mubarak had finally stepped down. Obviously, I think I made a couple of spelling mistakes here because I was so excited. Omar Suleiman, who was the Mubarak's deputy for a couple of weeks, said in these hard times, Mubarak had resigned. So it was important to get out the statement, but I rewinded for 15 seconds and I translated the exact statement, because sometimes the wording can be different, because Mubarak has resigned, yes, but what happened? So you could be caught in the euphoria. Well, then Mubarak has resigned, Egyptians have were successful, but the exact words was the next tweet saying Mubarak has resigned, yes, but he has given everything to the military council. So it's sort of a two steps forward, 1.75 steps back. So you really don't know where you are. And ultimately, I just have to say that it's important for all of us to keep in mind that we are affecting people's lives with the translation. It's not just, you know, a cultural or fun or the people do really rely on a lot of our work. Not me, I belong to your club for about 15 minutes, but I think that it does make a difference. So thank you for inviting me to this.
Approach and methodologies, from the contextualization, the cultural, you know, adding the cultural explanations and using dictionaries, of course. Our third speaker featured in the program, Dr. M. Ramail, unfortunately couldn't make it today, so instead our very own Dr. Joselia Neves will be presenting on the same topic. Dr. Joselia Neves is an associate professor in the MA program of Audiovisual Translation at the College of Humanities and Social Sciences. She has led a number of research projects with partners in the media, museums, cultural venues, the performing arts, and education. Her special interest lies in developing action research projects that contribute towards making communication environments accessible to all. While living and working in Qatar, she continues to collaborate with European universities, both as a visiting professor and a researcher. She is a member of the Transmedia Research Group and a board member of the European Association for Studies in Screen Translation. Dr. Joselia, the floor is all yours.
Thank you very much. Good morning, everybody. I feel honored to be stepping into my colleague's shoes. By no way will I ever be able to speak as well as she does. Aline Jamal, one of the best scholars in audiovisual translation. So my apologies for not living up to what Aline would be offering you today. Aline could not come for personal reasons, further to the unfortunate Brussels situation. However, her mother is in a poor state, so she couldn't come. But she did leave you a message. She sent it by email, and I would like to share it with you. Aline Remal says, I would have liked to tell the conference that we are holding up well in Belgium, and that translators are communicators and therefore peacekeepers doing an essential job. Keep at it, translation over bombs. It couldn't be more appropriate for our topic today. So what I'll be sharing with you is the vision of audiovisual translation for empowerment. Empowerment within this big topic of politics, politics being people wanting to be part of society, part of the world. Most of you all know what audiovisual translation is. Very, very shortly, audiovisual translation comprises all translation types that aim to make multimodal texts that use auditory and visual codes, make these texts accessible by taking messages across cultural, linguistic, and sensory barriers. As Yves Gambier once said, audiovisual translation in the end is all about accessibility, as is translation in general. We are making the other accessible to somebody who does not have the means to understand or achieve what somebody else is saying in another language, in another culture, in another context. When we talk about audiovisual translation, we often think about the simplified audiovisual translation types, where we have movements from speech into writing, and we talk about subtitling, from sound, music, speech, into writing or signs, and we talk about subtitling for different hard of hearing audiences. Sometimes we are traveling from speech into speech, and we are talking about dubbing or voiceover. Or we can take image into speech in an intersemiotic translation movement, and we might be talking about audio description for blind audiences. But these are only the simplified, common audiovisual translation types. But why do we say they are simplified? Because nothing is stable, nothing is there in audiovisual translation, because audiovisual translation is driven by technology. And as technology changes, we are all changing our ways of translating. Let's take subtitling for instance. Our traditional sense of subtitling is disappearing altogether. In the first image, you will see subtitles can now be explaining themselves in over titles rather than only as subtitles. Subtitles don't have to be boring and sitting at the bottom of your screen. They are taking new shapes, new colors, new movements. In fact, subtitles are breaking barriers, they are crossing boundaries, and we now find ourselves mixing this task of writing with interpreting. And in the situation of live subtitling with speech recognition through me speaking, what we are doing is written simultaneous interpreting. So our simplified versions of audiovisual translation are no longer there for us. However, audiovisual translation is becoming more and more a tool for empowerment. And if we think of what empowerment is all about, it's giving official or legal power to making something possible. However, empowerment is all about having power, but using it with responsibility. And when we talk about the responsibility of audiovisual translation, we have to think of it as translation in general, an activity where discourses meet and compete. There is tension all the time. And there is a lot of negotiation in terms of power relations that happen in the media and that will be happening in the translation itself. So if we are to talk about power in audiovisual translation, we have to think that power is shifting in many ways when we talk about the audiovisual translator. Because the audiovisual translator might be somebody like me, might be somebody like you, and will be what we have just heard. This is a case of a non-professional who, for a purpose, is doing live audiovisual translation and going to YouTube and looking for subtitles on YouTube that might not have been done by professional subtitles. So this movement shows that audiovisual translation has the power for change. And if we look at instances, Qatari's exercise in India, audiovisual translation is being used to educate children. And through songs, people are learning how to read. And literacy rates have risen tremendously. Here in Qatar, audiovisual translation is also finding a place for people with disabilities in a society that is still in need for inclusion. So again, why the simplified versions? Let's think of how audiovisual translation, how translation in general, can empower groups that might be minorities, might be suffering somehow of a social dire. We all know how audiovisual translation has played a major role in the Egyptian conflict. We see that people were tweeting about it, people were translating. Mona Baker has done fantastic research on this, and this is empowerment, making your your project known to the world. But this sharing, this fan-subbing circuit that is happening in the world is going in all directions. We have Vicky, we have Amara, we have collective community groups coming together, crowding together to subtitle for free. TEDx shows, for instance, or anything for educational purposes or not. Even Al Jazeera is already banking on free translation to provide subtitles online. Now, this is all very well. It's all about empowerment, indeed. We are now prosumers. We produce as we consume, and we no longer know who is the translator and who is the readership. These two have come together. There are severe and serious ethical reasons that we have to think about. Ethical issues, payment. These translators deserve payment, and being paid justly is also about empowerment. Authorship. Who is the author? Do translators sign their names at the end of their subtitles? Copyright. We are using these subtitles for piracy. Quality standards. How good are these subtitles? They are being used by people who might not have the ability to decide on quality of what they are consuming. And then, what are the norms? What are the guidelines? And more. Are these not sometimes being used for social and personal agendas? Hopefully, most of them will be very positive, they will be very proactive, but they might also be used in less favorable ways. So there is always this flip side to the coin. This is just anecdotal. 24 hours after the frames were shown in the US, China had everything subtitled into Chinese. And that's 24 hours between the US and China. So how fantastic this is, but what does this mean and entail? On the other hand, we have opposite movements. And if we think of South Africa that has so many national languages, minority languages, soap operas that are loved by people in general in South Africa, spoken in local languages, are all being subtitled into English. So again, this is a matter of empowerment and of disempowerment, because these languages could also be there in the translations. To finalize, all this said, what do we need in audiovisual translation? Two areas. We need more research and we need more action. More research on the complexity of the multiple local and global influences impacting the evolution and directions of audiovisual translation today. Things are changing so rapidly that the moment we finish a research project, it's obsolete, and we really have to combat it. The other basic need is we have to think of the potential effects on empowerment with self-reflexivity on the part of the researcher. We have to be researchers who want to make a difference. Finally, we want more action. We want high-quality education and training in audiovisual translation, in particular for empowered translators. And these empowered translators will have social engagement and a sense of community. And we need to raise the awareness of the public in general of the important role of audiovisual translators as mediators and promoters of social change. So, this said, audiovisual translation is transfer and construction, constraint and possibility, translation and accessibility, institutional, non-institutional, we are here doing it constantly, disenfranchisement and empowerment, representational, interventionist, produced, consumed, neutral, self-reflexive, local, global, and you could go on forever. Thank you very much.
We have Dima Khatib, do we? Shall we start Q&A? They're calling them right now. Let me just introduce. Dima Khatib is a journalist, writer, and translator. She's currently the managing director of AG Plus, a multilingual online digital channel based in Doha and San Francisco. She's currently in San Francisco. She joined Al Jazeera in 1997. Her journalistic career led her to work in over 30 countries around the world. Dima has been classified among the most influential Arab women on social media since 2011. Dima studied translation in Geneva University, Switzerland. She speaks 8 languages. She has 1 poetry collection in Arabic, Love, Refugee. And Dima's here, is she? Not yet? Hello, Nemo.
Yes.
Yes, indeed. I'm trying to put some light on so you can see me better.
Yes, that's perfect.
Okay.
Dima,
right.
I've introduced you. The floor is all yours.
All right.
Okay.
So I'm sorry I cannot be in Doha with you today. I was supposed to tell you a little bit about the challenges we have been facing in producing content, translating some content in AJ Plus in the digital world, but that's not going to be possible because I don't have my presentation and the people that were going to be with me. So I'm going actually to tell you a little bit, a little story about translation. Many of the students, some of them I know actually in this whole study, because they believe they know what a translator looks like. They believe, they think what their life will look like in the future. My dream as a child was to become a translator, actually an interpreter in the United Nations. So I built my whole life based on that dream. Even my parents built their own savings, their own plans built on that dream. And I made it to Geneva to study in the best translation school at that time at Geneva University, and actually became a translator at the United Nations, only to discover that that image of the translator I had in mind was not much fun to me, because I was basically repeating every day ideas that others produced and made and thought of into another language, and that was not enough for me. So I moved on to looking for something where I could produce my own ideas, make my own ideas, and that's how I became a journalist. Only I discovered that the strength I had compared to other journalists is the fact that I was a translator, is the fact that I could actually understand things, not just in different languages, but also understand them from different cultural perspectives, put them in cultural context, and reproduce them in the different languages into the different cultural contexts. And that gave me a huge edge over other journalists who could only see maybe things in one language or two. I had maybe four, at least five working languages where I could actively, as a journalist, not depend on a fixer, not depend on a third-party person to explain to me things. I could use my own cultural background as an Arab to understand things directly in the language that I speak, in the country that speaks that language, and basically not just translate the content, but translate the whole situation for my audience on Al Jazeera or anywhere else I have worked, in a way that makes them actually understand not just words, but also a whole concept or a whole history or a whole story. And that actually turned out to be one of the most interesting things in my career. You know, on Al Jazeera, you often find yourself reporting from conferences where leaders are speaking or very prominent people are speaking, and many times I've had to interpret as well as report. And I remember so many times when I was interpreting after a leader from Latin America, that I would make conscious decisions on changing, adding, or removing something based on the cultural concept or context of things. For example, a Venezuelan who's speaking, they will come up with an example that may not be acceptable in our Islamic and Arabic culture, about love or about how people communicate ideas in Latin America through body, through sex. This is something I could not have translated into Arabic literally, so I would come up with solutions and alternatives to convey the idea. And this was only possible for me to do as a journalist because I could understand the culture behind the two. In this case, it was Latin Spanish from Latin America and Arabic, my native region. So I want to tell everyone who's studying translation that translation may be just the opening door to a lot of things that you can do.
translation is definitely a fantastic profession where you can convey ideas from one language, from one culture to the other, but it can also make you very different in any profession you may choose or any profession that may come across your road. At the moment, I am managing a multilingual project, AJ Plus, online, and I can detect all the spelling mistakes in the different languages without having to go through someone else. I can understand the difference between lots of different contexts of our videos in the different regions. When we make the same video, exactly the same, about the same story, in Arabic, in English, and in Spanish. And I don't like us to just translate the videos or to make different versions of the same. I always tell them, you have to translate the culture of that video. So if we make a video, for example, about refugees, women refugees in Germany, riding bicycles for the first time, when you do it in Arabic, it goes without saying that these women had never ridden bikes in their own country, in Syria. For Arabic speakers, they will know that immediately. You don't have to explain that this is the thing that makes this video special. But in English, you do have to explain that, because English speakers may not be aware that riding a bike for a woman in Syria is not something people usually do, and this is where the challenge lies for these women in Germany. And the same thing in Spanish. And in fact, you can see in the comments below these videos that we did on AJ Plus how the comments under the video in English were all very positive, encouraging the women, and how the comments below the video in Arabic were all questioning why women would ride bikes, even though it was in Germany. And the cultural, let's say, discussion was very different between the two videos. Now, this is something that a translator would understand very well if they take into consideration that translation is a cultural voyage that will take them and should take anybody who follows whatever they produce, whether it's written, whether it's visual, whether it's spoken, whether it's produced in any form, it will take them into that voyage. And I believe that the more we take into consideration that translation is not just about language, the more successful we become. Thank you very much. I'm sorry I'm making it very short, but it's going to be very difficult for me to do that by Skype. I find it very impersonal, but I'm happy I at least like made it on your screen.
Thank you, Dima. We're very happy that you made it today. And as you said, we try to promote translation and the Translation Interpreting Institute and show change mindsets and show how it's an added value to any profession you may choose. Let's open the floor for questions and answers before Dima sleeps. I know it's midnight there. And I don't know if you can tilt the camera so she would see us. Is it a possibility? The Skype camera, so she would see her fellow speakers as well? Okay, so questions?
Is my friend Sultan Al Qassemi there?
He is. We need her to see him, please. Questions? Yes, please.
And Mr. Sultan, Ms. Giselle, please give our regards and support for your friend and yourself from all Qatari nationals, of course. And for Mr. Sultan, my question for you, how was your family life in the past few years doing this all live translation online? How was it? It seems like you've been working like 24 hours, 7 days a week. So how was it?
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
I only did the translation for a few weeks. So beginning maybe the end of December 2010 to about March, to be honest with you, I got tired. So that's why I said I belong to your prestigious club for 15 minutes. Whereas you have you know, your lifetime to enjoy this great job.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I love what you were doing in Egypt. That was great to hear.
Yes, please. There.
Thank you. السلام عليكم أشكرك لتحتك وزاري حابساً مستر سلطان Do you think that everybody is liable to be a successful translator even his background in Arabic or other languages quite well and he is qualified from undergraduate from a college? To what extent? What are the, I mean, the characters that the translator should have? Charisma, for example, or what? Even though his language is quite good, but I think you can't accept his accent, maybe his background in the language, I think that he couldn't influence the audience or what. Thank you very much.
Yes, so the question was, do you think anybody could be a translator? What about accent and knowledge and things like this? I actually think that, it's a big responsibility. I feel that when I felt overwhelmed, I stopped because this is something that was momentary only. It was only for a few weeks. And then it's not something that I'm professional in. All of you are so much more knowledgeable than I am. But there was a period of time where you guys are doing the real work, and there was a vacuum, there was a hole in the world that needed to be plugged, which was instantaneous translation. And by the way, maybe one thing I could say about my own work is I wasn't shy about admitting mistakes, the saying that I mistranslated that statement, please correct. But I even contacted newspapers and I said, by the way, Time magazine, by the way, Newsweek, Shamarich does not mean gunshot, you know, so for example. But it was important to rectify the mistake and insist that they correct it because forever it will be there. And also, it's important, I think, to have an understanding of, if you're talking about Arabic language, to have an understanding of what is now known as modern standard Arabic. So I understand Egyptian accents very well. I know Levantine accents very well. I had an issue with some Algerian and Moroccan words, but I think over the past few years, I improved my understanding of other accents in the Arab world. But there's no way, I think I have a 25% grasp, to be honest with you. It's quite challenging.
That's why I like your English, by the way, because you speak many difficult dialects and the various of dialects, so that's what made me to accept your translation. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
ما أدري هل هذا له سبب معين أو لا. ثنائية ثنائية النص أو ثنائية الترجمة كعملية كبروسس كمرحلة تبدأ بعملية يعني يدخل فيها المترجم في علاقة مع النص معينة إلى أن ينتج المنتج النهائي أو في من ينظر إلى الترجمة على أنها نص مجرد فقط يخرج عنها نص مترجم في هذا الشكل. يعني أقصد هذه الثنائية بين الترجمة كعملية والترجمة كمنتج. رأيتها اختلفت من الثنائيات اللي أنت قدمتها، فما أدري هل هذا سبب معين، هل له سبب معين أو لا؟
السبب هو في الزوجين، النص والنص المنتج. ولكنهما يلتقيان في النص. فهذا نص في اللغة المصدر والآخر هو نص في اللغة الهدف. وقد يتحول النص في اللغة الهدف إلى نص المصدر للغات أخرى. وهذا هو إخصاب أو عملية الإخصاب الحاصلة في عملية الترجمة. فكلما نقلنا ضاعفنا من إمكانيات الفهم والإفهام.
جميل، هل ترى أيضا عملية النقل ما بين النص الهدف أو النص الأصل والنص الهدف مثلا؟ هل ترى عملية النقل هذه أيضا ممكن أن ينتج لنا ثنائية ثانية مثلا؟
بالطبع. وهنا تحدثت عن صناعة الكتابة وصناعة الترجمة.
جميل.
زوجان.
جميل. لدي سؤال آخر إلى دكتورة نفس. أنا have to talk in English. I liked your audiovisual translation, but I think you didn't touch on technology at all. And I don't know why it's that. This is also under the remark.
I did it on purpose. Hoping that somebody would have picked it up, and thank you very much for doing it. Because at a stage I said everything in audiovisual translation is technology based, and technology is constantly changing. The topic here is beyond technology, and audiovisual translation should not be tagged to technology alone, because a lot of audiovisual translation happens in the analog world. And I hope translators working in audiovisual translation will be analog for very, very long. I'm afraid that very soon they might also be technology-based. So we are talking about empowerment, and I'd like to see human beings empowered over technology. But thank you very much for asking. It shows that it worked.
Do you still have 5 minutes for questions? Yes, please.
Oh, sorry. I'd like to thank the panelists for their presentations. I find the case of Mr. Sultan very intriguing. Mr. Sultan, do you consider yourself as a translator or a bilingual writer? Because the work that you're doing does not fall in the dichotomy that Professor Awaiss has talked about. So it seems to me that you are more of a bilingual writer than a translator.
Can I answer?
Yeah, please.
I am not a translator. I am not a translator. I am not a translator. What I do is, in the period that there was a seismic shift, there was an earthquake. There was a platonic movement of the plates of the Arab world, and there was a major vacuum, and I stepped into that vacuum. People wanted to know what was being said. What is Qaddafi talking about? What is Mubarak talking about? They wanted to know now. They didn't want to know 18 hours later, you know? And that's where there was the second by second, interest in the Arab world. I remember I had 3,000 followers in the beginning of Qaddafi's talk. I had 9,000 by the end of it. So it just shows you, and this is early 2011, so it just shows you that there is genuine interest in the world. You know, I'm a businessman, I make money from finance and investing in Qatari stocks, which I'm very happy with, by the way, investing in Qatari stocks. But I'm interested in writing about culture in the Arab world and in the Gulf especially. So, and I had access to a computer, I had friends in Egypt, I was in Cairo 3 weeks before the revolution. So I go there all the time, and it was easy. Even when they cut off the internet, I called my friend, what's going on, and I put it on the internet, you know? So you remember that they shut down the internet for a few days in Egypt? So I'm not a translator. I was an interpreter for a few days, for a short while, maybe a few weeks. I hope that answers your question.
Yes, your production, I think, is very important in the sense that it provides external evidence to the theory translation, because the examples that you bumped into would raise questions about the traduction. For example, the example of the words that you, or the terms that you did not understand for you to translate them into English, suggests that all the time we claim that the language that you translate into is more important than the language of the source, but your case shows the opposite. Sometimes the language that you translate from would be more important than the language that you translate into. So again, this case again shows that the dichotomies that we all the time talk about, which make of the models which would help us claim that translation is a science, I think it's not the case. So translation is more of a philosophy of language, even linguistics in the dichotomies that Professor Awaiss talked about as a science. To me, it does not look like it, because it's more of a philosophy of language than science.
It's a science, it's a philosophy, and it's also an art.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you to all the speakers. My question is to all of you, and perhaps Sultan's spoken about this before, and I'd like to see if he has anything else to say about it. With the building and foundation of all these cultural institutions, translating HBKU now, which was Bloomsbury before, and we have all these, you know, like Al Jazeera, all these cultural and translation institutes, we have a geopolitical shift in power centers, or what they used to refer to as soft power. has it gone past soft power? Have they become major power players, these Gulf states? Thank you.
I think I should give a chance to other people to speak.
I'd like to hear your opinion as well. I've read your article, but I'd like to, it was in 2013 when they first emerged.
All my opinion is in my article.
Nothing else has been added.
أنا أريد أن أعقب على مزاء عند الزميل. أولاً أذكر بمثل فرنسي يقول أن سول إيرونديل في بال برينتان طائر سنون واحد لا يؤدي إلى فصل الربيع. وإذا كانت الجزيرة أو غير الجزيرة محظوظة بأمثال الزميل سلطان فهو سنون واحدة، وهذا لا يغطي كل عملية الترجمة ولا كل التدريس. وأريد أن أضيف مثلاً لبنانياً يقول أعطيه خبزة للخباز ولو أكل نصفه، يعني الخباز هو المترجم. قد يأتي محرر صحفي بارع يغطي حدثاً معين بلغتين، عنده حسن التصرف، عنده سرعة البديهة، يبحث، يؤدي به الأمر إلى عملية تواصل هائلة في تغطية الحدث، ولكنه سنون واحدة. وأنا أعول دائماً على مؤسسة، على أن يكون للترجمة مؤسسة في الجامعة وأن تعامل كمعرفة كسائر المعارف التي تدرسها الجامعة. شكرا.
ديما، would you like to add something? Do you think translation is considered a soft power rather than a political tool maybe?
أولاً لم أكن أعرف لأنني لم أكن أتحدث بالعربي، يعني كنت أعرف يعني.
ليست جريمة.
هذه معضلة بالنسبة لي في قطر، الكل يتحدث معي بالإنجليزية أولاً، يعني فأنا أرد بالإنجليزية تلقائياً، ولكن لو كنت قد خيرت بكل تأكيد كنت تحدثت بالعربية منذ البداية. الحقيقة أني أتفق كثيراً مع الدكتور بأن الترجمة يجب أن تدرس كعلم منفصل. أنا درست الترجمة ودرستها 4 سنوات كاملة كدراسة أساسية، كما يدرس الأدب، كما تدرس الهندسة، كما يدرس الطب، وهذا طبيعي. هذا لا يعني أنها لا يمكن أن تستخدم فيما بعد في مهن مختلفة، بالعكس هذا يقوي من أهمية الترجمة بأنها يمكن أن تصنع من المترجم أكثر بكثير من مجرد العمل في حقل الترجمة. ثانيا أريد أن أعقب على كلام مهم جدا قيل من شخص مغاربي إذا لم أكن مخطئة تحدث قبل قليل عن لغة المصدر واللغة الأخرى وما هي اللغة الأهم بالنسبة للمترجم. أريد أن أؤكد على مفهوم قد يكون خاطئاً لدى كثيرين ممن يدرسون الترجمة أو يودون دراسة الترجمة. أن تتقن لغتك الأصلية هو أهم 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 عنصر للنجاح في حياتك كمترجم. إن كنت لا تتقن لغتك الأصلية اللغة الأم، أو إن لم تكن لديك لغة أم، وهذه معضلة منتشرة جداً في الوطن العربي حالياً ولا أجدها منتشرة في أي منطقة أخرى في العالم، هو تقريبا يعني ضمان لفشلك في إيصال أي فكرة بأي لغة، لأنك لم تكن تستطيع أن تفهم الفكرة أو المصطلح أو الحدث أو القصة أو التاريخ أو الثقافة التي تقبع داخل تلك اللغة، فكيف يمكن لك أن توصلها إلى لغة أخرى أو إلى قالب آخر أو إلى ثقافة أخرى، وكيف لك أصلا أن تفهم أي شيء يحصل بلغة أخرى وبثقافة أخرى؟ عليك أن تعيش التجارب كاملة مكتملة بلغتك الأصلية وأن تستطيع أن تفهمها وتعبر عنها وتتصالح معها بتلك اللغة حتى تستطيع أن تكون ناجحا بأي لغة أخرى أو ثقافة أخرى. وهنا أنا أتفق معكم بأن المفهوم خاطئ جدا طبعا، بأن إتقان اللغة الأجنبية هو أهم عنصر للنجاح. بالعكس، أنت عليك أن تتقن أولاً لغتك وأن تعرف ذاتك الأصلية بالداخل، أن تستطيع أن تفكر بحرية بلغتك الأصلية حتى تستطيع أن تنجح بلغتك. وشكرا اني تحدثت بالعربية. الذي قام به. أنا كنت تزامن دوري في تويتر مع نفس الحقبة التي سماها سلطان بالزلزال الذي تحركت فيه طبقات الأرض العربية. أنا كنت في فنزويلا وقتها وانخرطت في نفس العملية التي كان يقوم بها سلطان، لكن نحو أمريكا اللاتينية باللغة الإسبانية ونحو أوروبا باللغة الفرنسية، خاصة أن الثورة التونسية كان الكثير يكتب عنها من تونس باللغة الفرنسية. فأنا كنت أترجم مهنياً وصحافياً وثقافياً الأحداث التي تدور في تونس من اللغة الفرنسية إلى الإسبانية لإسبانيا وأمريكا اللاتينية وحتى إلى اللغة العربية وإلى الإنجليزية، وأعيد نقلها بالفرنسية مع وضعها في السياق التاريخي والسياق الإقليمي والسياق الثقافي، لأنك عندما تنقل الحدث أنت أيضاً تترجم الحدث حتى باللغة نفسها. من يكون موجوداً على أرض الواقع لا يمكن له أن يضع الأحداث في سياقها، هو ينقل الحدث كما يعيشه بمشاعره التي تنجم عن ذلك الحدث، ولا يمكن له ربما لضيق الوقت، ربما أيضاً لضغط الأحداث التي تكون آنية وتكون سريعة، لا يمكن له أن يضعها في سياقها الذي ينبغي أن توضع فيه كي يفهمها المتلقي بلغات أخرى أو حتى باللغة نفسها. فأنا في نفس الوقت الذي كان يقوم به سلطان بتلك المهمة، وهو قام بمهمة رائعة حقيقة في نقل الأحداث باللغة الإنجليزية بطريقة تجعلها مفهومة كأحداث ومفهومة لغوياً أيضاً ورقمياً، لأن اللغة الرقمية تختلف عن اللغة الرسمية أو اللغة الصحفية التقليدية إذا أردنا أن نسميها. وفي تلك الحقبة واجهتني ربما تحديات مماثلة لسلطان في نقل المفاهيم خاصة بين أمريكا اللاتينية والوطن العربي، مفاهيم ما هي الديكتاتورية؟ ما هي الحرية؟ ما هي الديمقراطية؟ اكتشفت بأني حين أترجم كلمة ديمقراطية مثلا بين العربية البرتغالية والفرنسية والإنجليزية والإسبانية، هذه هي الخمس لغات التي عملت بها على نقل الثورات العربية على تويتر، بأنني لا أنقل نفس المفهوم. بين أمريكا اللاتينية نفسها، بين كوبا والبرازيل، مفهوم الديمقراطية مختلف تماما. بين الوطن العربي، حل الديمقراطية لدى المواطن العربي كان مختلفا عن مفهوم الديمقراطية لدى المواطن البريطاني أو المواطن الفنزويلي. فحتى عندما تكون الكلمة واضحة والمصطلح متفق عليه تماماً، هذا لا يعني أنك تترجم المفهوم بالكلمة. لذلك أؤكد على السياق، وهذا ما فعله سلطان، هذا بالضبط ما فعله سلطان، كان يحاول أن يشرح المفاهيم، وهذه تحديات كانت تواجهني كل يوم حين يرد علي مثلاً المتابعون في فنزويلا أو في كوبا أو في أي بقعة في أمريكا اللاتينية عن حكمي على نظام القذافي أو نظام بشار الأسد بأنه كذا أو كذا، لأن مفهومهم عن الديمقراطية يختلف عن مفهوم الديمقراطية الغربي الذي كانت تصله المعلومات باللغة الإنجليزية أو باللغة الفرنسية بأحكام مختلفة تماماً. فلذلك الترجمة فن كما قال سلطان، لأن عليك أن تأخذ بعين الاعتبار كل ذلك. وهنا أذكر ربما بمقولة إيطالية أكيد كلكم تعرفونها، تراتوتوري تراديتوري، المترجم خائن مهما فعل.
شكرا بحضورك.
شكر للمترجمين الفوريين اللي كانوا معنا اليوم. فعندنا مترجم two interpreters.
Valuable input. Thank you for the audience for contributing to the discussion. As for now, we will have a coffee break for about 15 minutes. And following that, we will have three panels running at the same time until 12:20. And they are the eyes and ears of politics, translation and political, and literary representations of power. After that, you will have lunch from 12:30 till 2 p.m. in Exhibition Hall 1. And you will also get the chance to check out our interpreting exhibition at the same time and venue. Our coffee break right now is in Exhibition Hall 1, so please go ahead. Thank you so much, and we hope you enjoy the rest of our sessions for the day.